Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Which are proposed by the AFIO. We had seen the Blaney-Criddle method. We had gone into the various aspects of Blaney-Criddle method which are proposed by the AFIO. Before we go to the next method, which is the radiation method, I'd like to give you the various nomenclature which the FU has used in all these methods. They have used this climatological nomenclature which helps in putting these climate variables into different categories, because wherever the data is not available, it was felt that it's better to take a range, and a nomenclature is used to express these ranges, and that I thought would be better if we at least look at how they have been differentiated, how they have been put in these ranges, the various major climatological factors, temperature, mean temperature is used. The mean temperature is the average of maximum and minimum temperature. In most of the places, you will find that normally the two temperature readings are taken. The temperature is recorded continuously, but out of those values which are recorded, two values are picked up. One, which is the maximum observed value, and the other, which is the minimum observed value. And the mean temperature is nothing but as the, if you have maximum temperature and you have minimum temperature, if you take the average of those two values, that's what is the mean temperature. When the mean temperature is more than 30 degrees centigrade, then the conditions are known to be hot. When the mean temperature is less than 15 degrees centigrade, is called cool conditions. Similarly, humidity. In the case of humidity, you will find some methods, they require the relative humidity, minimum relative humidity to be used. And some other methods require the mean relative humidity to be used. So while using the relative humidity, minimum relative humidity, these are the various climatological levels which have been used, low, medium, high. And these are the various ranges of the levels which are associated levels for the minimum relative humidity. Now the mean relative humidity, these four levels have been defined: low, medium high, and high, and these are the associated ranges. Less than 40%, 40 to 55%, 55% to 70%, and greater than 70%. Similarly, the wind, again, they are two different units which are used to express the wind conditions. One is in meters per second, and the other is when you are using the wind run for the whole day. And that situation is expressed in terms of kilometers per day. So there is only a conversion factor which is differing the two. In one case, again, they are the average, the wind speed can be instantaneous, because when you are observing, you are observing the instantaneous values. But then if you average them out over the whole day, then you can express them either in the form of meters per second or in terms of the average wind run for the whole day. What is the wind run in terms of kilometers per day? Okay, and these wind conditions are expressed in terms of light, moderate, strong, very strong. Most of the time you will find that these conditions are picked up from the weather reviews. Every area has the published records, because these conditions are used only in those situations where you don't have the actual observed data available. And you are using the average conditions which are influencing the evapotranspiration activity to a great extent. So in the absence of those actual values, you are using the average values. And since these average values are either average over time, or they are values which are representative values for that area, because when you look at the weather records, the weather reviews which are normally published by the local meteorological office, you will find that they are available on the monthly levels, or or those records are not in the form of actual data, the instantaneous data, they are in the form of average values. So these are the average conditions. There is a reason that these average conditions are defined, so that you can make use of these average conditions and you can incorporate them while computing the evapotranspiration values. Or for the time being, we are discussing only ET0, which is the reference crop evapotranspiration value. So these, in the case of wind, sometimes you might be getting the wind in relative terms, that you are having the wind conditions which are light, and there might be a corresponding explanation that if it is, what are the light conditions? Light conditions are when you can experience the wind on your face. Moderate conditions, there will be conditions when paper can blow. So you might be having some thumb rules to decipher these conditions, or there might be some conditions which you can express in terms of the actual happenings, and you can designate these conditions, general conditions, with respect to those occurrences, if you don't have the records available in terms of the actual values or the average values. So even that is possible. Similarly, the other other parameters, radiation. Radiation can be expressed in different forms. It can be either in the form of sunshine hours, and if it is in the form of sunshine hours, it will be there. The N by N ratio, will come to these terms later after a while. These three conditions are expressed low, medium and high, and these are the ranges. Then cloudiness, and if the radiation is expressed in the form of cloudiness, then there are two ways by which the cloudiness can be expressed. There is one system which is known as 10th system, and there is another system which is known as octa system. So these two ranges are given, and these are the nomenclatures low, medium and high, and these are the corresponding levels. Now next let's come to the next method of calculation of ET naught, which we had seen that in this method you have the observed data on temperature and sunshine, and the radiation data can be used if it is available. If it is not available, you can use some relationships for this particular data. And this method, this is the expression which is used to represent the radiation method, and this ET naught, which is the reference crop evapotranspiration for a period under consideration expressed in millimeters per day, is a function of RS, which is the solar radiation in equivalent evaporation. Solar radiation can be expressed in many forms, but in this particular expression, the solar radiation is converted into equivalent evaporation expressed in millimeters per day. And W is the weighting factor, which depends on temperature and altitude. And C is the adjustment factor, which is dependent on the mean humidity and daytime wind conditions. So again, you'll find that if we compare this with the expression used for the Blaney cradle, it looks a similar expression. In all these methods, you will find that a factor has been used, which is basically the improvement which has been done on the method. This factor, because there are, in all these methods, it has been found that there are some of the factors which are very active, and they are making a lot of difference. They might not be making difference in terms of the computation of ET naught when the conditions are within the condition, within the range for which the method has been used, or for which the method has been formulated. But when you go beyond those ranges, then the method was not performing very well. So there are few experts or the team which was entrusted with this particular job, they have tried to look at all these methods and go beyond their recommended ranges and see how they perform in those ranges, in those areas in which they were not developed, or which were different from where they were developed. And that's how they have come out with some recommended additional constraints or additional factors which can be incorporated, and some corrections can be made. Let's go into the the various elements, that how do we find out the various elements of this equation? First of all, the solar radiation, RS. When we want to know RS, RS is basically, let me use this. If we, this is the sun. Now from the sun, this is what is the cause of the solar radiation. The rays which are coming and traveling towards the earth, if this is the earth, the radiation which is coming up to the atmosphere, if this is the level beyond which the atmosphere makes a lot of impact, then this component is, sorry, this component is RA. The solar radiation which is approaching the atmosphere, which is reaching the atmosphere, now this solar radiation RA is basically a function of only two things. One, the latitude. What is the latitude of the place which you are interested in, which you are considering to find out how much is the solar radiation which is coming to that location? And the second is, which is the period in question. So the location is defined with respect to the latitude and the hemisphere, which hemisphere you are. And the latitude with respect to the hemisphere will pinpoint which is the location in question. And then the variation with respect to the period. So there is a table, which is a unique table, which is a fixed table, which gives the extraterrestrial radiation RA for different locations on the Earth. And that is the table which is with respect to latitude and the southern hemisphere, northern hemisphere, and for different months. These are some of the values which I picked up just to show you, because the table and the full form, this is the table which gives the RA value for, this is the latitude, the southern hemisphere, northern hemisphere, January to December, and these are the different values. So once you know the latitude, you know in which hemisphere it is, you can use this table to find out how much is the solar radiation approaching the atmosphere. Okay? So once RA is known, this is the maximum radiation which can come, which can reach the Earth at a particular time for that specific location. This remains fixed. But what happens? Some part of this radiation is absorbed by the atmosphere. So it depends on the conditions of the atmosphere. It is a function of atmospheric conditions. How much of this radiation will get absorbed and how much will be scattered? So there's a part which is reaching the Earth's surface, that is known as the RS. That part is known as the solar radiation. And this can, it can be directly measured, is fine. Otherwise, it can be obtained from this expression. Where you are using the sunshine ratio, this n by n is a sunshine ratio, which is expressed as the ratio between actual measured bright sunshine hours and maximum possible sunshine hours. Now this maximum possible sunshine hours, again, as we have seen in the previous lecture, that this is something which is fixed. The maximum sunshine hours, again, is a function of which location and what time of the year. So there is a table which gives the maximum, the mean daily duration of maximum possible sunshine hours at different latitudes and for different months. And this table gives you a value which is n value, which is the maximum sunshine hours, possible sunshine hours, which is the difference between the sunrise and the sunset, which remains fixed. So it's independent of whether it was cloudy or it was not cloudy. You are looking at what are the possible, if there is no cloud, then what is the possible number of sunshine hours? That is what is given by this table. And the small n which is used here, the small n which is used here is the actual measured bright sunshine hours. As basically, there is a possibility that if the sunshine is not, or the solar radiation is not reaching the Earth's surface, is because of the fact that there is some cloud prevalent at that particular location. So the activity of evapotranspiration will be totally influenced by the number of sunshine hours which were prevalent at that particular time, or during that duration. If you are taking a particular month, in that month how many sunshine hours were there and how many sunshine hours were possible, that ratio is used to find out what is the solar radiation which is reaching the Earth's surface. Okay. So once you know what is the RS, in which you have taken into account the effect of the clouds, how many, for how long the clouds were there, to find out the small n value, there are various ways by which you can know what is the n value. There is an equipment which is quite often used, which is known as, in general, the sunshine recorder. The Campbell Stokes sunshine recorder is equipment which is quite often used to find out how much is the number of hours which are actually sunshine hours in a particular day. And the way it is done is that you use a strip of paper and you have a globe, a ball through which you let the rays of the sun pass. The paper is attached behind this ball, so it has the same effect as when you take a lens and burn the paper. It has a similar effect. So it will, depending on for how long the sunshine was available, it will have the paper burnt for that duration. So it can be calibrated, and you can at the end of the day you can find out what is the length of the paper which is charred, and accordingly you can find out what is the N value. So the actual sunshine hours, you can make a measurement on those sunshine hours using the. And the cloudiness can be expressed in the form of octas or tens. So this is the relationship between N by N ratio and cloudiness. If you have the cloudiness available instead of N by N ratio or the sunshine ratio, then you can convert that cloudiness into the equivalent sunshine ratio, so that you can use it in the equation to find out the ET naught. And this relationship or this conversion again is available in FEO 24, a publication on crop water requirement. All this material which I'm using, you can refer to crop water requirement publication or the research paper on irrigation and drainage division by FEO. They are given all these relationships and all these details in a very elaborate manner. Now next, let's have a look at the weighting factors W, which we have, because the equation in the equation ET naught is equal to RS into W into C. That is what we have, the relationship. So we have looked at RS, the solar radiation. W is the weighting factor, which is used to differentiate the impact of temperature and altitude on ET naught. So this table, you have the temperature. There is a temperature given on this side from 2 degrees centigrade to 40 degrees centigrade, and for different altitudes, the altitude varies from 0 to 4000. The values of W are given here. Now you can see here that as we go closer to higher temperatures, the factor is approaching 1. That means the conditions under which the equation, the radiation equation has been used or has been formulated as such, it was more near such conditions, this area, where it was closer to 1, where the temperatures are slightly higher on the higher side, and even the altitudes are also somewhere in this range, from 500 meters to around 2000 or 3000 meters. In this zone, where the values can even go to 0.43, when the temperatures are 2 degrees centigrade, that means the lower the temperature, it was felt that it was giving very high results. It was over-simulating. The values which you were getting, they were much more than the actual values. That is why a weighting factor of almost half or less than even 0.5 has been recommended. Now coming to the last factor, which is the correction factor, small c. Again, a table has been recommended, a graphical. These four different figures have been recommended, where only two parameters are now used. One is the relative humidity, the mean relative humidity. This is RH mean, Is it visible? Or I'll write here. This particular the relative humidity, mean relative humidity is medium to high, 55% to 70% in this figure. And when the RH mean is high, it is greater than 70%, then this figure is recommended. Again, in constructing all these figures, again the regression analysis, the stepwise regression analysis has been done, and that is how these figures have been obtained, by taking each individual parameter into consideration and looking at its impact. The other parameters which are used are the daytime wind conditions, the daytime wind speed, and there are four different wind speeds which have been taken: 0 to 2 meters per second, 2 to 5, 5 to 8, and greater than 8 meters per second. So these four are represented by number 1, this is number 1, number 2, number 3, and number 4. Curves. And depending on these two parameters, the relative humidity, this is the mean relative humidity, and the wind conditions, the value of C has been recommended. So on this side, you have, this is basically W into RS. The W into RS, once you find W into RS after finding out each individual item, you can look at what is the relative humidity, mean value of relative humidity. That can be found out, and then you can find out which is the relevant figure. If the relative mean humidity is high, use this. If it is medium high, use this. If it is low, then this figure is valid. If it is low medium, this figure is valid. Then you can find out what is the U daytime wind condition, the U daytime, and which particular condition is valid. Accordingly, choose the appropriate line, and then you can find out what is the value of ET naught. So, having W into RS value available, and after knowing which is the corresponding RH mean which has to be used along with the wind conditions, you can directly use this, go up in this direction. If 2 is the U day condition, then move horizontally, and this value, the value can be read, this value is ET naught in millimeters per day. If you don't want to use the graphical presentation, then this can be converted into some tables which can be used in a computer system. You can, only thing is that you will have to interpolate between the two values. So the linear interpolation can be done. If you get a value which is in between the two values, because then you will have to give all these points in the form of either equation or in terms of the actual values for different levels. So if you give in terms of the actual values in the form of a table, then you will have to have incorporate interpolation procedure, and that can also be done. It's not difficult. The packages are available where the interpolation is resorted to. You don't have to actually use these figures. These figures can be converted into equivalent tables or in the form of some equations which can be directly used. But if you are doing it manually, then it's much easier to use these graphical figures. Now with this, the method on radiation is taken care of, and this method again is quite, it gives reasonably good results And it depends on whether you have the data available, which is the required data. Now, coming to the next method, which is the Penman method. This method is the most efficient and most accurate method. But at the same time, it requires a very, very large amount of data. If we again go back to the same figure, what is the data which is required for the Penman method? You will see that it requires the data on temperature, humidity, wind conditions, sunshine data, and as well as the radiation data. This method was put forward by Penman in 1948, and at that time the method was basically, it was introduced to find out what is the open surface evaporation. Later on, it was felt that the same method can also be used for evapotranspiration, because basically the factors which affect evaporation is the same factors which affect the evapotranspiration also. So when you talk of evaporation from water bodies, that is something which is the potential evaporation from the water bodies. As when we say potential evaporation, what we are saying indirectly is that there is no dearth of availability of moisture, or we are saying that there is no constraint on the availability of moisture. That's why from water bodies, whenever you say evaporation, is always at the potential rate. Whereas the other thing is not true. If you are talking in terms of the evapotranspiration from the soil surface or from the land, is not always at the potential rate, because it's dependent on what is the availability of moisture in the root zone depth. So when you say evapotranspiration, though in all these equations which we have seen so far, in all these methods which we have treated so far, we are making an inherent assumption that there is no dearth of moisture availability. There is no constraint on the moisture availability. That's why the ET naught which we are trying to find out, the reference crop evapotranspiration, it is the potential value. It is the maximum value which can take place in those circumstances or in those conditions. So, to find out the grass evapotranspiration, and that is where I think, I'm not sure, but I think maybe that is the situation in which the grass was thought of to be used as reference evapotranspiration medium, where this was done in England, and the Penn evaporation, the Penman equation was used to find out what is the evapotranspiration from grass. It was found that by just multiplying the E naught, which is the open surface evaporation given by Penman, if you multiply that by a crop coefficient ranging between 0.6 to 0.8, you can get the evapotranspiration for the grass. But at the time of this intercomparison, or the FU team, when they looked at the Penman method again, they found that is really very difficult to find out which crop coefficient should be used. In some situations, 0.8 was quite a satisfactory value, but in some situations, 0.8 was not. It was giving quite high estimates. So they have used all this information in giving a revised form of Penman method. The method remains same, only they have introduced a revised wind function, which we'll just discuss. Let's first have a look at basically what is the difference between the Penman method in comparison to the other methods. In the Penman method, two terms have been used in the Penman equation. One is the energy term and the other is aerodynamic term. Because it has been seen that whenever you are trying to estimate the evapotranspiration activity in a particular at a particular location, in some situations is the radiation term, or is the radiation which is more prevalent. For example, if the conditions are very calm, the weather is very calm, you will find that the energy term will become very important, because the activity of evapotranspiration will be dominated by the radiation which is prevalent at that particular location. But on the contrary, there are some situations where you will find that if the conditions are very windy, if the conditions are such that the wind and humidity, they are influencing the evapotranspiration activity, then the aerodynamic term will be more predominant. So there is the combination of these two terms which will be in a position to approximate or simulate the conditions in a better manner. The level of the extent of their involvement is a function of the actual conditions. So if you have an equation which can take into account both these factors, then that equation will be more useful, it will be more accurate, and that's the reason that the Penman equation has a better chance of performance, or its results are much better in comparison to the other equations. Let's try to look at the equation as recommended by FAO, which is only a slight modification, only in the form of this wind function, and the C factor has been introduced. This is the equation. In which this W into Rn, this component is the radiation term, and this part is the aerodynamic term, whereas this part is the radiation term. Looking at the various elements of this equation, W is the temperature related wetting factor, Rn is the net radiation in equivalent evaporation expressed in millimeters per day, Fu is the wind related function, Ea minus Ed, this term, is the difference between the saturated vapor pressure at mean air temperature, that is Ea. Ea is the saturation vapor pressure at mean air temperature, and the mean actual vapor pressure of the air, which is Ed. Both expressed in millibars. And C is the adjustment factor, as we had mentioned earlier also. This adjustment factor compensates for the effect of day and night weather conditions. Now, each of these terms, how we can compute each of these terms, that is what is our next question, and that is where you will find that you have, if you will ultimately look at this whole procedure, you will find that this is quite a laborious thing, the terms, the number of terms which are involved, and these also in turn involve many other terms which have to be looked at. But at the same time, method has been made quite simple by providing the various relationships in the form of either the graphical representations or in the form of tables, and we'll have a look at all those things in detail. So we'll try to take each of these elements one by one and try to look at what is involved in computing those individual elements, and which are the various tables which are available. I think we should leave that to the next class, because if we'll start that, we won't be in a position to finish